Computer Science and Engineering Colloquia features accessible talks by leading computer scientists and computer engineers from across the region and around the world.
I'm here to welcome our keynote speaker, Noah Smith, who just joined us 2 months ago. Noah did his bachelor's in both computer science and linguistics at University of Maryland, did a PhD at Johns Hopkins, and joined the faculty of Carnegie Mellon University. As I said, he saw the light and came to UW in Seattle a couple months ago. We are very excited to have him as part of the program, particularly having hired also Yejin Choi, who joined us from Stony Brook a year ago, and adding the two of them to Luke and various others in the department who do NLP really gives us incredible strength, plus people in electrical engineering here as well. Noah is particularly known for his work in NLP that crosses other areas, including social sciences. He's going to talk about that today. Thanks a lot. Welcome, Noah.
Thank you, Hank. I'm really excited to be here. I'm excited to talk to this crowd. It's great to be in a town where I can sit down at a random table and the person two seats over is working on NLP. So natural language processing is my field. Today I'm going to talk about using natural language processing and text data to discover the social world. So this is an example of why this is such a fantastic time to be a computer scientist. We are suddenly realizing how relevant computer science is to every other academic and non-academic pursuit. So here we are looking at things like language change using computer science. So this is an example of a project looking at new words on Twitter. I've chosen a handful of new words that popped up in one region of the country or another. I'm not sure how well you can see the slide. I'll pick one example, this term AF. You can see the translation over on the right. You can't say this on NPR. It started in Southern California in the early period of our data set, or a little bit before. And if you track its usage across about 3 million users over a 3-year period, this is a very large data set, you find that it spread across the country, and suddenly it really caught fire and took hold across the southeastern US. And so if we look across the vocabulary of terms that are used on Twitter, we see dynamics like this all over the place, where a term starts in a new place, pops up, and then spreads, or doesn't. Like, there's this term ARD, it seems to be a Philadelphia thing. It means like all right, and it didn't really go anywhere. It didn't catch on, right? Why is that? Why do some terms catch on and others not? Why does language pick up and move and change the way it does? This is a fascinating set of questions. And in the past, it's largely been studied by sitting down and conducting interviews with very small populations of people. But today, we have social media, we have microblogs like Twitter, and we can gather massive amounts of geolocated messages with timestamps. We know something about the people who said them and where they were, and we can track this sort of change. So here are examples plotting the frequency of terms over time in different locations. So this is an emoticon. It's a special kind of smiley made with two hyphens and two underscores. And you can see it kind of picked up in New York, and by the time it was on the wane in New York, it was starting to pick up in Chicago and San Francisco. Okay, so maybe big cities are important. Maybe big cities like New York have big effects on other cities. There are others like CTFU. This is from the region I used to live in, CT cracking the F up. It's just a term for laughing. There are many terms for laughing on social media. It seems to have come out of Cleveland, and then it kind of picked up in Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, Youngstown, and other places a little bit later. These are all kind of geographically close to each other, right? So some terms may be sort of regional dialect. Using thousands of terms like this in aggregate and doing a statistical analysis that infers not only the frequencies but the relative effects that geography have on a term's usage, we were able to build this sort of subway network of American cities. So the blue links are showing bidirectional influence between two cities through a time series analysis. So Seattle seems to have an effect and be affected by Minneapolis, Portland, San Francisco, and Boston. And it has an effect on lots of other cities across the West, from Denver down to Los Angeles and so on. So this is kind of interesting, and we can actually then use this sort of network induction algorithm across the continental U.S. to start asking why. What are the factors that seem to affect language, the movement of words around the country? What are the factors that matter for influence? And so I'm just going to summarize the findings. I could talk about this all day. It seems demographic similarity matters a lot more than proximity. So two cities that are close to each other, there's definitely an effect. But if those two cities are demographically similar, for example, Seattle and Minneapolis, racial similarity seems to be the strongest piece of this story. Also, bigger cities do tend to be more influential, and that's consistent with past theoretical models. Lots of people, more linguistic influence. Another sort of counterintuitive finding is that wealthier cities tend to be more influential. Okay? This is not the same as wealthy individuals. And in fact, in the past, it's been argued using traditional methods that language change is not led by wealthy people. It's actually led by lower socioeconomic classes. And there are really interesting stories here, and the lesson is to remember that wealthy cities don't just have wealthy people. Right? So wealthy individuals don't always live in wealthy cities either. So interesting disconnect between looking at the macro scale and the micro scale. People sometimes worry that because of the internet, language is being, you know, any new technology is destroying the language, right? And the internet is often blamed for changes in the language. In fact, existing sociolinguistic fault lines seem to still be preserved and are visible in language on the internet. There's still dialects. There's still diversity in the ways people talk. The internet is simply reflecting those patterns as they have always been. So I want to change gears and talk about another project that was done a little bit more recently, looking at influence on a much smaller scale, but a very important set of people involved. The abstraction here is part of a growing research area within my group, thinking about the idea of persuasion and influence through language. Something that's really, really important in all of our lives. Here are some examples of where you have a goal and a target, and someone is trying to talk the target into accomplishing the goal, right? Think of a coach that's trying to talk an athlete into doing what he needs to do to win a competition, or a scientist who's writing a paper, this hits close to home, when their goal is to get a favorable review so their paper is accepted and the target is the referee of the paper, or the reviewer at the funding agency. Or think of an attorney who's trying to convince a judge or a jury to rule in favor of his client or her client. Okay. So you could imagine also to help the target on the sort of other side of the coin, helping someone who is being persuaded or on whom attempts are being made to persuade, to call out persuasive versus substantive elements of an argument. Right. Think about upcoming elections. Wouldn't it be great if your browser could tell you not just what people are saying, but help you see when they're being persuasive and when their language is really being engineered to influence you, and when they're really talking about the issues. So this has led to what we're calling decision theoretic models of language, and the first place where we've applied this is a really important small set of individuals, the United States Supreme Court. Okay, so these 9 people make major decisions that influence all of our lives, and it's all done out in the open and publicly, for the most part. The way that the Supreme Court hears cases, for people who don't know, there are 2 sides. They're called petitioners and respondents. Each side presents briefs to the court which describe the facts of the case. They're called the merits briefs. And in addition to that, something that is sort of intriguing and interesting and provides a really nice window into the larger social context of what's happening in these cases, you have these people called friends of the court who file what we call amicus briefs. And amicus briefs present the facts of they don't present the facts of the case, they present the case in light of, other issues. And these are groups like the ACLU and the Cato Institute. Right. They have an indirect interest in the outcome of the case, but they want to persuade the judges one way or the other using arguments that are closer to the way they care about the issues. Okay, so an amicus writes very careful, purposeful briefs to influence the court, and they're paid a lot. These are lawyers. Okay, these are lawyers who are very carefully chosen and heavily incentivized to maximize utility, to win the case. To sway the justices to their side. So we think of them as utility maximizing agents when they're choosing the words they're going to use to present the case. Okay, very brief primer and an important idea from political science. Often political scientists treat the ideology and decision-making in policy space as a geometric, there's a geometric metaphor that they use, where they think of each of the people who is making a decision as lying on a spectrum. These are called ideal points. Each of the justices lives at some point on this scale. I'm just giving a hypothetical scale with three of the justices to get the idea in your head. And then what happens is each case essentially separates the justices somewhere. And those on one side are likely to vote one way, and those on the other side are likely to vote the other way. Okay, so this model can be extended to many more than one dimension, like I showed on the slide. In fact, we're using 30. And there are nice techniques for incorporating text to estimate the positions of the justices and the cases in this space. This is sort of a classic thing to do. And what we've done is we've added in the amicus briefs and information about the amicus writers into the model to try and capture how much the justices are swayed one way or the other. This is the last math slide, I swear. Given that we have a probabilistic model, we can actually start talking about what expected utility means. We can describe a utility function and say you're trying to win the case, you're trying to get maximum number of votes on your side without swaying too far from the facts of the case. We have a nice formalization of that, we plug in our model, and it turns out that gives us a really nasty constrained optimization problem. Does anyone here work on optimization? Okay, so two people in the room can appreciate this. Instead of solving this really, really nasty problem, we resort to something called a random utility model. It goes back to before I was born. And the idea is that you assume that instead of being perfectly rational, people make choices that are random, but with a mode on the optimal thing, right? So they stay close probably to the optimal decision, but there's some noise. Okay, so we took 23 terms of the Supreme Court, and we ran our model. There are a number of interesting machine learning and NLP tricks involved in getting this to work. And at the end of the day, what we can do is build visualizations like this. So this is a case, a death penalty case, Maples v. Thomas, where our model beautifully predicts each of the justices exactly where they should be. What's nice about the visualization is you can ask what would have happened if each side of the amicus briefs had been the only side that had filed briefs, and you see that the model believes really strongly that Thomas and Scalia could have gone either way. Looking at the purple and pink triangles, that's showing you each of the sides on its own. It also would have gotten a rather different outcome if it hadn't used the amicus briefs at all. So the orange triangles are showing you zero is completely undecided. Left means you're coming out against the death penalty in this case. Right means you're coming out for it. So wherever the green dot, which is what our model predicts, is on the opposite side as the orange triangle, this is a case where the amicus briefs led to a better prediction. We can also ask questions, and I think this might have real value eventually in certain circles. You can ask, before you write your brief, what would be the optimal balance between different topics that I should focus on? So taking the Obamacare case, NFIB versus Sebelius, very high profile case from a couple of years ago, it turned out if you go and you look at the briefs, you find that those who were arguing against Obamacare used a topic about the individual mandate and how it was not acceptable for the government to impose this on people. And those who were arguing for Obamacare were saying this is really an interstate commerce issue, of course the government can do this. And so if you ask what would be the optimal trade-off between emphasizing one of these topics, individual mandate versus interstate commerce, you get about an 80-20. For this case. This might have been useful for the lawyers on the opposite side. Maybe things would have come out differently if they'd had more NLP, I'm not sure. We can also use this to predict votes out of sample, and we find that our model does significantly better than everything else we were able to replicate or think of using the same data or less. So what we're finding is that if you read additional texts, if you give your computer program more to read, it gets better predictive accuracy, but only if you model the goals of the people who are writing the text. Okay, so it's not just about what people say, it's what they're trying to accomplish. So there's a lot more to do going forward. We can imagine using a lot more evidence, reading more documents, looking at cited cases, looking at who the amici are. We're not really paying much attention to that. We might imagine that this is a game, and the amici are thinking about what their counterparts on the other side are going to write, and then it gets really interesting. And we might go to deeper representations of text. We used a really pathetically simple way of modeling the text in this project. We might want to think about the actual argument structures and what people are saying. So anyway, the punchline is we're now modeling not only what people say, but why they say it and what they're trying to accomplish when they say what they say. So these are two examples of projects where we're looking at influence, but there's a whole lot more to do. Text serves as evidence for things from ideology to issue framing, which is more substantive view of this idea of influence, and even hard things in language like sarcasm and how people are presented, how we choose to convey what we want to say about individuals can tell us a lot also about authors. So I'll stop there, note who my collaborators are. I'll be around this evening if people want to talk more. And there are plenty of papers to read if this interests you. So thanks a lot for the opportunity to chat.